Ladies and gentlemen, Hayward's 40 Speakers are proud to bring for the fourth time this week to the Lowry in Manchester, the legend, the greatest of all time, the king and the man that is Eric Cantona! Good day for you United fans. Eric predicted in the afternoon show we did today, he predicted 3-1. He was close, but the right number of goals for United was the thing that mattered. First question then, Eric, all that time ago now, why did you decide to come and play football in England?
I was in France and I was playing in France and I decided to retire from football. I was 24. I retired 3 months. I was playing for France and Michel Platini was the manager of France. After 3 months he came to me and he said, you have to come back. I said, yeah, why not? But I don't want to play anymore in France. He said, maybe England. I said, yes, why not? So I arrived in Sheffield. Well, I spent a week. I thought I was there to sign a contract, but Trevor Francis, a great manager, decided to... After a week, he said to me, you have to stay 1 more week and try. We played again during the week I was there. We won 4-2 and I scored 3 goals. So I left. I went to Leeds United.
When you got to United, most people think it was Sir Alex's best ever signing, the best decision he ever made. And then you were really the reason they had so much success. When you, every time you walked out on the pitch for Manchester United, did you always think you were going to win? Yes. Yeah, you all thought you would.
Yeah, since I was a kid, every time you come on the pitch, it's to win the game. And you train hard during the week to win the game in the weekend. Yes, of course, but it's not really easy. You know, you have some bad things come through your mind every time. So I was fighting against the idea of losing. But like in everything in life, sometimes it's coming through your mind. It's fucking singing. And you have to fight and be positive. And I've been lucky to play with wonderful players in this wonderful club and win things and with a great manager and great fans.
So much so that in reality you became the most popular player in United's long and illustrious history, I would say. And the fans to this day sing your name 20 years after you left.
Yep.
Like this.
We are, we are, we are, we are, we are, we are.
70.
So the question was going to be, before you helped us, is that what does it feel like when you hear that everywhere you go?
It gives a good, strong energy. It's not only me, all the players. You know, it's why United win very often games in the last minutes of the game, in the last 5 minutes, even today, you know? It's because you are the 12th man, and you deserve medals and trophies, as much as us. I don't care about trophy, I can give my trophy if you want to. I got my memories enough, and I got that feeling, and this strong feeling. I love to win, of course. The idea of winning a trophy. But the trophy, I don't know where they are. Yeah. Should be somewhere in France.
Lots of people have asked me to ask you who were the best players that you played with in your career. Not specific one, but which players did you feel great playing with?
I played with wonderful players, and I played with... How can I say one name and not another? We've been fair for the other one. I played... As I told you, I was lucky. I played with Smyshell, I played with Giggs, and Beckham, Mark Hughes, Robson, Zidane, and it's difficult to say, I cannot say one name, to be fair. I've just been very, very, very lucky.
How about, is the one name that was the hardest player you played against? Or are there several of those as well?
I think they remember me more than I remember them.
We'll rephrase it. What was it like? Because the class of 92, the Scholes, Giggs, Nevilles, and Beckham, they all say that you were an inspiration to them. What was it like playing with them, and what was it like mentoring them, or however you went about it?
When I was 17, I played with a great player called Zarmak, who was a Polish. He played 2 World Cup semi-final, and he helped me a lot. And you have, when you become older, to kind of a player. When you see young players, you're a bit afraid, you know, because they want to push you out. But you don't care, you just want to help them. And I remember when I was 17, always remember that, and I said to myself, when I will become older, I will try to help the youngest one. And I try. Yeah. I don't speak a lot. I don't like the idea of being an example. Yeah. I just walk as I did before, hard. And very, very hard.
So, obviously you were a great fit, Sir Alex and yourself, but why was he such a great manager for you, or for United even? What were the qualities that Sir Alex had that other managers didn't have?
Just know football much better than the other ones. He's a great, yes, of course, he's also a great man, with a lot of humanity and humility. The next game is always like it was the first one. He has his own vision of the game, and he made us believe in his vision and give us that energy we needed all. And we loved him as a friend, and we respected him as a boss. And that balance very difficult to find, even as a human being. As a father, it's very difficult. I got 4 kids, and to be loved as a friend and be respected as a father or boss, it's very difficult. And he has this genius. He was just great. Anyone with different generations of players. I read he was 45 or 50, and he retired, he was 17. And when he retired, he played with a generation of players who spent nearly all the day on the mobile phone, you know? Calling and playing on a mobile phone, listening music with headphones, they live in virtual world. And he was 70 and he won the league with this kind of robots. He's just a genius.
So, assuming he's won, who were the other big influences on your life and your career?
Sorry?
Who were the other big influences on your life and career?
The first one was my father. My father was a goalkeeper. It was great, so I started as a goalkeeper. I was 10, I played in a team, and every weekend we won 6-7-0. So I waited all the week to play the game and never touch a ball. So I decided to play up front and scoring goals. And I never moved. And I came back as a goalkeeper. My father was a great psychologist. And year after year, I realized how great father he was. He always never said to me that I was good. He always made me understand that I was good. And also that I have to work hard to be better the next game. So it was very important for me. And then it was Johan Cruyff. I was born in 66. It was a great year for him.
Eric Cantona was born.
And in the early 70s, it was a great team, Ajax, Amsterdam, and Holland. And the leader of them was Johan Cruyff. And Johan Cruyff used to say, before you receive the ball, you need to see everything, anticipate every movement. You know, so I remember that till now, because he helped me as a player and he helped me as a human being. Because it works in every kind of business, in every kind of relationship. When you are beat in front, you can anticipate everything. It's easier, much easier. It's never easy, but it's easier. So sometimes people say that the footballers are a bit stupid, you know. But when you listen to somebody like Johan Cruyff, you learn maybe more than the pundits say, you know, sometimes. Journalists, everything. Once make everybody understand or believe that they are very clever, you know.
We'll go straight on to the kung fu kick, I think. It shocked people at the time. Nearly ended your career. It's viewed now with affection that you stood up to the abuse of such an idiot, really. What are your memories of that time of your life, the kung fu kick time?
What did he say?
I used to say that I should have kicked him out. But sometimes I say something and the day after I say another thing, because I'm free like a bird. For the people who think that I made a mistake, I would say to them that mistake is a hidden desire. A hidden desire, you know. And for the other one, I say it was a real desire. So I really enjoyed it. I'm not sure he enjoyed it. But I learned about it, and I'm sure he learned about it too.
Yeah. They're all shouting for him. Came to the press conference after the court case, and I think it was the solicitor at Man United that said, "Eric, you've got to go and talk to the press." Would you like to tell them what you said or what happened there?
After the court, it was a room full of journalists, like today, you know. And I didn't want to say anything, I wanted to leave. And the lawyer from the club said to me, "You have to say something." I said, "Okay, I will say something, don't worry." And I cannot just say something. I could have said, "Oh, a cat is flying with the wings of an aeroplane. It's so loud." You know? But the journalist, after 20 years now, they try to analyze it. And say that I'm towards philosophical, that I am a philosopher. I don't think they read a lot of books of philosophy.
So what did you say?
What did I say? Everybody say what I said.
They want to hear you then.
When the seagulls. it's because they sing sardines will be thrown into the sea. Thank you.
So 9 months out, what a long suspension that was, and you came back and played against Liverpool. Made a goal after 3 minutes. Went 2-1 down, and then came the penalty. I say it every night, with the nerves of steel that you've got, up you stepped. There was no doubt in the fans' minds you were going to score. What went through your head after 9 months out and then pressure?
9 months is very long, and I couldn't play even a friendly game. So it was difficult. I trained very, very, very hard for 9 months, but the game is very special. The game is very special, so I missed the game. So I was a bit worried. So when I see the first one, it was a kind of, yeah, small liberation, but when I scored the penalty, it was liberation completely. But after this game, for 2 months, I didn't play very well because I just needed to play a game. But Alex Ferguson kept me in the team, and he helped me a lot. He knew that I will come back at my level when, we never know. But after 2-3 months, I came back at my level, and we were 12 points behind Newcastle. And we started to win and win and win. We played Newcastle, we won. And then Kevin Keegan lost the control of everything. And we won the league.
A few people have asked about the current set side, and if you ever watch the current United side, what you actually think of them, or in fact, would you like to have played with the current side?
I don't think I'm too old. I think I could play. I could score. And I think it's a great team. Yeah, Mourinho started slowly. He won a lot of things in many clubs. He's a winner. He's a very defensive. He has a defensive vision of football. But he realized, because he's very intelligent, that the fans, United, they want to win, but they want to enjoy the game. So now he's starting to play more attacking football, a little bit more. And it works. Because the last few months they did very well, and today they won the League Cup, which is the first one, the longest ever in the league.
Someone shouted out for a few years saying, "Do you think Zlatan is? Do you think Zlatan is close to being a king, or is it just Eric Cantona?"
It can't be only one king. But he can be the prince if he wants. No, it's a great player. I'm just joking. He's a great player. He's a great player. He's a great example for the young players. Also. Yeah.
So, in a way, you weren't as old as him when you were there, but he's being an example like you used to be all that time ago, I guess.
Sorry?
He's being an example to the young players like you were examples of young players.
I just say that.
I know. It's that. No, we didn't say you were.
Well, you think about something else?
No. Okay, so after retiring from football, did you ever regret it, says Chris Smallbone. A customer, someone out there. Did you ever regret it when you retired? Do you think you retired too early?
No, I don't think so. I was 20 years old, and I said to a journalist that when I will lose a passion for the game, I will retire. I just played football like when I was a kid and playing in the street. I had a fire inside of me. I just played to enjoy the game every time. But when I lost the passion for the game, of course I would have loved to play. Yeah, I miss playing, but to play well, you need to train hard, yeah. You need to be careful in what you eat, what you drink, yeah. What time you go to bed.
Exactly.
And I was tired about that. I was very, very tired. It's a lot of sacrifice to be at your best. So I just retired. I didn't want to play for money, not just money. No, I just want to enjoy, I want to feel alive.
So you did retire and you found something to do straight away pretty much. Well, you went to beach soccer, so you retired from normal football, went to beach soccer for a
while. Yeah, beach soccer, it's a wonderful game. Beach soccer was born on the beach and with the sun, so everybody thinks that it's not a real sport, but it's a real sport. I don't know if you try to run on the sand. It's very, very difficult. So you have to be physically very fit and technically it's wonderful. So in 2005, we won the first FIFA World Cup in Rio de Janeiro, in Brazil, in front of 12,000 people. The pitch is 37 meters on 20 meters, so it's very small. And when you have 12,000 people around you, it was a great atmosphere. So it's a great memory for me. But now I retired after since 10 years. But it's a very respectable sport.
So you went straight into acting, which sort of probably helped to keep the adrenaline going when you became an actor.
Okay. I would have become a bandit, you know.
Yeah.
It's difficult after football because football is so strong. It's like a drug. So physiologically, you miss something when you play 3 games a week or 2 games a week, and you miss something. Your body misses something. So it's very, very hard. And I've been lucky to have other passion, and thanks to my father and my mother, my parents, to give me the sense of observation of the world and to have observe the world and try to understand it, to create my own world. And yes, I always wanted to, I just want to play and express myself. Football, it's a game, so we play football and we express ourselves. In cinema, or in theater, on stage, we just express ourselves, and we play. So I never lost the idea of game, enjoying the game. Because life is, I'm lucky to do this kind of thing, and yeah.
So probably the film that nearly everyone has probably seen is Looking for Eric. I hope you've seen Looking for Eric. Yeah. What was it like working with Ken Loach?
It was great to work with Ken Loach. It was great to work with Ken Loach. It was great to meet him. With my brother, we wrote some things on 2 or 3 pages, a story, a relationship between a fan and me. And we went to see the best one, we thought. And he was the best one. And we have been lucky that he said, yes, we have seen him with his script writer, Paul Lavertine. And the producer Rebecca, and they said yes. So 2-3 years before we shoot, and it was a great adventure. And the way we shoot, it's very unusual. And all the actors don't know the script. I knew the script because I was involved before, but all the other actors don't know the script, and he shoots in the chronology. And every day, at the end of the day, it gives the lines for the day after. Like in life, you don't know what tomorrow will be. So it was a great experience, and I remember when the first scene I was involved in, Steve Ebbets, who is a main actor, was in front of a poster. Nobody knew that I was there. He was in front of the poster of me, and he was speaking to this poster. And I was hiding by everybody, and so I came slowly behind him, and I started to speak, and he heard my voice. So he turned, and he had a very strong reaction. But everybody was ready to shoot. And in the Ken Loach movie, you always have this kind of reaction. It's not only acting, it's reacting. It's why his movies are so great. It's one of the greatest for me.
I don't know if you know this, but Eric's quite a big collector of art. And I'd just like to ask who your favorite artists.
My favorite artist is Banksy. I don't know if you know Banksy.
Banksy.
I love it. He did a piece of art. It's a quote from Pablo Picasso. Pablo Picasso said, "Bad artists imitate, great artists steal." Picasso. So Banksy came, just scratched Picasso and write Banksy.
We love him, but we don't know who he is.
Maybe it's me. Maybe it's somewhere. Maybe it's my wife. He did something in New York. He worked in New York, you know, he spent a month in New York, and he said, for every day I will do a piece of art. So everybody tried to know Banksy and tried to catch him, the police, everything, the mayor of New York, and nobody catched him. And at this time, my wife was in New York. So maybe she's Banksy. Maybe it's why I love so much Banksy. Because I have a lot of doubts. You know? I love my wife too.
Do you see any similarity between football players and artists? Because there's football players that are artists, maybe.
What's an artist? Yeah. Somebody paints and we say he's an artist, and another one in front of the same painting, we say, I don't think this man is an artist. Footballers are the same. Some footballers, you think they're artists, and the other one, you say no. But of course, it's easy to say that Messi is an artist. It's more difficult to say that Vinnie Jones was an artist. Or Del Rudo. I don't know if you remember Del Rudo. You remember him?
Everyone remembers Neil Ruddock for all the wrong reasons quite often, probably. Second of all, do you think football's an art?
I think football is an art, yeah, definitely. It's an expression of ourselves. And it's used by artists, it's used by politics. It has a lot of influence in the society. I think football definitely is an art, yeah, it's very... It's a beautiful art, yeah. It's a major art. It's not even a minor art. It's a major one.
So, with that in mind, who's your favourite current player in the game today?
It's Modric. Modric who played for Real Madrid. He's the brain of the team. They speak a lot about the one who scores goals and everything. Yeah, there's a lot of players, great players in Madrid, but I think he's the most important one. When he doesn't play, the team is not the same. He's a real brain of the team. Everything starts from him. He's got a sense of anticipation. He knows everything before the other ones. He's a great player.
Very proud of the trouble that you had in your career a long time ago. What do you think now of the FIFA scandal that's been going on?
Oh, yes. When I was banned for 9 months by the FA, the FIFA banned me for 9 months because I should have been an example. The FIFA scandal. They are a great example for everybody. A great example for the kids. Huh? They could have... What's that jacket? Yes. But FIFA is not different than the other business or politics. It's just the same. We live in a war, in a completely crazy world. Yeah. And football is not different than the other ones, unfortunately. But we have the game and we have to fight very hard to keep this game alive. The game.
The Sky television money, there's huge amounts coming in. Do you think this?
Sky and the other ones, you have a lot of money involved in football, yes. They sell the right of football. If you want to create an event, you just And you go to see the sponsor. The sponsor will say, is it on TV or is it on, is not on TV? Is it in newspaper or not? Now you have game everywhere, on TV, in newspapers. They all make money with football. And so sponsors, they spend a lot of money in football. So players, journalists say that the player earn too much money, but they earn money, the media, the televisions, because they speak about football every day, newspapers, because they speak about football every day. And they want that the player don't earn money. Players are the main actors of that system, business and circus. You know? And I think the one wants who are responsible of that business are the majors. So when the FA sells the rights, millions, or thousands of millions, I don't know the price, it's so high, everywhere in the world, they should ask, I think, the chairman, the clubs, to keep a quarter or half of the stadium on the cheap price for poor people, because football is a popular sport. It's a popular sport. And unfortunately, poor people cannot go anymore to the stadium. And it's sad for the fans, and it's sad for the kids also. Me, I remember when I used to go to the stadium with my father, I was 10. And I could feel the atmosphere of the game, the stadium and everything. And I learned a lot about what I've seen, what I felt when I was in the stadium. I remember Alex Ferguson used to take with us when we played in the Champions League, players, young players, they were 17. They were not in the squad, but they were traveling with us. They came in the dressing room and felt the atmosphere of a big game, you know, and he knew that it was important. But now, the kids from poor area, they cannot go to the game anymore with their parents. And I think in the future, they will become a professional, but we miss something. Something that we can tell, we can see, but something magical.
The clubs protect the players a hell of a lot these days, probably against reality. Do you think they prepare the players enough for when football suddenly stops and their life has to start after football?
I don't think so. I think the players are too protected. We need to protect players. In my time, before or now, we need to protect players because they need to play at 100% of what they can. But they are also human beings. Football is 10 years, and life is a long life. And they are parents, they are husband, they are son, they are cousins, of brother, friends. And they are, I think it's very important to keep them open on what's happened around them, you know. In the world, it's not because they live like it's teddy bear world, you know, or Mickey Mouse world, Walt Disney world, you know. They should keep an eye open on the world around them. See that in the street you have homeless people, you have refugees people, and life is not easy for everybody, you know, and put their headphone out sometimes. And it will be, I think, great for them today, and it will help them, I think, for the future, after football, to come in a reality, you know, reality of our society. Because when you retire from football, as I said before, your body needs something special, you are on drug. So, if you are not prepared to be in front of that world, you're even more depressed, or you become a pundit. The science of the football. Then what do you think about football? Give advice to everybody, and when they become manager, they lose 3-4-0. But they have great advisors. Yeah. Scientists. Or you become a pundit, or you become desperate. Yeah. Or you become a pundit and desperate. When or you could become a pundit, desperate, who makes those ones desperate.
When you were at United, what with the collar up and, you know, the kung fu kick and other things, people used to call you a rebel. Do you think you were a rebel?
Yeah.
I don't think I am a rebel at all.
No, you are.
I met players who are rebels. We produce a documentary on rebels. And there is a Chilean, Carlos Caselli, who played in Chile in the 70s. He was a great, he's one of the best player and South American player, and he fought it against the dictatorship in Brazil, in Pinochet, so hard that his mother was tortured, nearly killed, and he fought for the democracy in Brazil. So his life was in danger. He's a rebel. We can't call this kind of man a rebel. And Socrates in Brazil did the same with his club, with Corinthians. They fought against the dictatorship in Brazil for the democracy. So we can call them real rebel. Because now you see somebody with a tattoo, I got a tattoo and I'm a rebel, you know? You think I'm a rebel? I don't think so. I'm lucky, I was born in France, I live in France, I live in England. I never lived during a war. And I've been in front of many kind of situation. So I know myself when in this kind of situation, but I've never been in kind of situation when you are 20 years old and you are in the Second War, you know? Should I have been a collaborator or a resistant? I don't know. Now I can say, yes, I'm a man, I would have been a resistant. But who knows? Nobody knows. What I can say today is that I am not a man. I am Cantona.
Cantona, where you hadn't even been a footballer, who else would you have liked to be?
I don't know. Who have been a... Thanks. Who have been, I don't know. Who have been maybe an animal. A snake or zebra or a hyena. Or a mosquito in the wind. I don't know. Or maybe Banksy. He's great, famous, nobody knows who he is. It's great.
This is just a sign. This is amazing that on Monday night Eric was in Croatia for his latest film and the premiere of it. Just to show you, I don't know, the depth of things that he's able to do, I'm going to ask him to tell you about the new film and his cinema projects. And
I was in Croatia for a premiere of a Croatian movie because I played in a Croatian movie in a Croatian language. I don't speak a word of Croatian. I don't understand a word of Croatian, and I had the main part of it. So I read the script in French. I walked out the scenes, the psychology of the scenes and everything, the characters and everything. And then I had to work on the dialogues. Stajovo, ke vas je pustio u moju sobu. That's Croatian. It means what happened, who took my stuff. So I worked very, very, very hard for 3 months. I nearly become crazy. I was speaking on my own on the plane, on the train, in the car, at home, in the bathroom, in the kitchen, everywhere. My wife nearly killed me. And then left me. So I said I will never do it again. Never. But I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. Because I worked so hard and I like challenges. I worked so hard that I could play with those ones. But it was very, very, very long. Made me nearly crazy. And I said I would never do it again. And in June, July, I will be involved in another movie. In Chinese. So I think I become completely crazy. But who is crazy and who is not crazy? Who decided to put a limit there and not there? I put a limit wherever I want. I'm free. You have more people, more crazy people in the street than in a psychiatric hospital. When you see Donald Trump, you think he's a normal guy. I don't think so. You take a McDonald's, you take Donald, the duck, you mix them, and you got Donald Trump. So, I would love to see Donald Trump playing in the Chinese. And he became president of the United States.
Perhaps you could become president.
Cantonese, yes.
Not in Cantona.
It will be Mandarin.
Not in Cantona, in Cantonese.
Yeah. You think I'm stupid, but yeah.
I'm getting it tonight, like, did you?
You tried to explain me what it means to Cantonese and Cantonese, Cantona.
No, no, I don't think you were stupid, but I was making a joke. I mean, do you work as hard in preparing your characters for a movie as you did when you were preparing to play in the game?
It's another game. It's a different thing, but it's the same everything in life. We need to work hard. Why? To find the confidence to enjoy it. In football, in cinema, in many things in life, it's the same. So it's just a different game. It's a different technique. And it depends on how we are, the life we are also. Take emotions and everything. I can have a lot of emotion, you know.
You know?
I can cry. I'm a strong man who can cry.
No. When did you cry last then?
The last time I cried? I think I was 2.
Well, a few people have asked me to ask you, will you ever return to Old Trafford, or would you ever become a manager?
If I become a manager one day, I will become a manager of United, yes. If it's not United, no. No, definitely not.
Because we haven't mentioned the commissioner. Have you seen the commissioner? Yeah. So have 60 million other people now. Is it fun to make those?
The self-appointed. Nobody can appoint me, only me.
Because England had a chance, didn't they? You offered your services to be manager of England.
Yeah, but they don't want to win. They didn't give me the job. Since 50 years, I don't want to win. They are happy. They go to the World Cup and a week after, they come back home. But Ireland is a great team. Iceland is a great team. I'm joking. It's Mr. Commissioner. Yes. We speak about football, we act and we play and we enjoy it. That's it. Nothing more than that. I could have become a pundit. I'm so lucky.
Maybe the next commissioner film you could talk about pundits.
Oh no. Oh no, they don't deserve it. And I don't think they could understand anything.
So, lots of people we know that if they were going to have their the last meal, or they could have a meal with three people that they ever wanted to meet in their life, you would probably be one of them for a lot of these people. It would be. It's excluding your family, who would be the three people that you would have for a special meal if you could meet the three people you really wanted to, or your last meal even? Who would you choose?
I'm not in an hurry to have my last meal.
No, you're not. So who would they be?
Hey, I'm 50.
Yeah, very young.
Hey, I don't know. Ken Loach. Alex Ferguson. And Donald Trump. And because it's my last meal, I can kill him.
I don't know what to say to that one. Eric told me when we were driving around somewhere this week that since when he retired, or since he's retired, you've only played in 3 games of football since. Do you not miss it?
I don't miss, no. Don't miss a game.
Oh.
No, I don't miss. When I retired, I didn't want to watch a game, you know,
no.
Because it's so, as I told you before, it's so strong. And it's like you're on drug and you meet your dealer. I didn't want to watch the game, so now it's okay. But I played 3 games. I played a game for the Ryan Giggs testimonial. I played for Diego Maradona in Buenos Aires, in La Bombonera, for his testimonial also. And I played, I can't remember the third one. Maybe I was teaching Vinnie Jones in my garden or something like that. Oh, never heard of. And I made them playing against each other. Something like this.
So you don't miss it at all anyway, is the answer to that one. Cup final, 2 penalties in a cup final. You scored the first penalty. Did it cross your mind to let someone else take the second one, or did you?
Why?
Well, because of nerves, because of nerves. You don't have nerves really, do you?
No.
I could have taken the third one.
Yeah. Being the only player to score a hat-trick of penalties in a final, if it happened.
I had a chance to score an hat-trick. I had a chance in the last 10 minutes and I missed them. I missed it. Only one. Huh?
Didn't miss many. Yeah.
But we won. We won 4-0. Yeah.
Got a question that not to do with football, really, but what does happiness mean to you, Eric? What does happiness mean to you in your life?
Happiness means a lot. Happiness is a very simple thing sometimes. Yeah. To appreciate the wonderful things, to find the energy to fight against the horrible things. And sometimes we travel and at the end of the world, you know, and we have some wonderful things next to us and we don't even see it. Happiness is to spend the time with my kids, going in the land somewhere, eating on the grass. It's just simple thing, moments of ecstasy. You know, that's happiness for me, it doesn't cost any money.
Yeah.
Somebody here has asked, which player from all the players of all time, if you could have had the chance to play alongside, who would it be?
One player?
Oh, several if you want. Some great players that are different generation, who would you love to have played with?
United players?
Anybody, with the United players to start with and then open it to the world.
United players I played with some of them. Yeah, I would love to play along with George Best. Maradona. Mario Kempes. Higuita. Goalkeeper from Colombia. All this kind of player, you know. I love this kind of player.
Obviously, Cruyff.
Great, and Johan Cruyff, of course. Yeah. Who is the best? Georgie.
What to you would be the perfect goal? There is
the perfect goal.
Yeah, maybe the perfect goal that you scored.
I never scored the I never scored one from just a simple goal, you know. We have seen some wonderful goals, spectacular goals, but we have never seen this one. The goalkeeper touch the ball once, give the ball to the right back, and then the right back and one touch, give the ball to the center defender, and everybody, 10 players, they touch the ball once, and the last one is me, and I put the ball in the back of the net, like this. This is simple. We have seen some wonderful goals in football since a century, but we have never seen this kind of goal. Never. So simplicity, sometimes it's very difficult. But if I become a manager, the manager of United, I promise you that my team will score this goal. It's exactly like this that Donald Trump became the president of the United States. He's saying some crazy things.
Well, this is our seventh show of the week. We're coming to winding it down now slowly. I hope you're all going to sing him out when we finish. As we, the top of your, not yet, the very top of your voices. And loads of people have asked this all week, and there's loads of people today asked it. What is your favourite goal that you scored in your career?
When I was a kid, I dreamed about scoring a goal in the last minute of a cup final. Against the biggest rival. Sharing that moment with all the teammates and the fans and feel something special. So, the Liverpool goal. I don't know if you have the same feeling. I don't know if you were born in 96. Well, you were born in 96.
I wish I was born in 96.
Yes, you remember? So it was a great feeling for all of us. So, for many reasons, that's my favorite one. For lots of reasons.
And lastly, the perfect pass, your best ever pass.
Come on, just say it.
It's a pass made to my mother. Oh, she runs so fast. I love my mother. Oh, maybe to my wife last night. I love scoring goals, of course. But give a pass to somebody, the pass that you dream to receive from somebody. It's an unbelievable feeling. It's like giving a present to somebody, you know? It means like generosity, it's very selfish. Just do it for yourself. But I prefer to have this kind of relationship with people through football or in life. Just share great moments all together.
And you've shared great moments tonight with the King of Old Trafford. I'm sure you're going to sing to him at the top of your voices now. Please thank him for coming out tonight. The King of Old Trafford, Eric Cantona. The legend that is Eric Cantona. Thank you very much. One more time, ladies and gents, Eric Cantona!